All right. Good morning and welcome to the faith community of North Christian Church in Columbus, Indiana. We are an open and affirming congregation of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. We welcome all as Christ has welcomed us. We are glad to have you in worship with us today. We have a lot on our calendar for today, believe it or not. At 11:30 on Sunday, the 23rd today, we will be sharing at Coffee Fellowship as we have resumed that practice now that we are doing online only worship. So I hope that you will join us. It's just a wonderful opportunity to connect with your faith family in an informal way. So please join us for that at 11:30. And then at 12:30 today, we have a general board meeting. So those of you who are members of the board, please connect with us on Zoom at 12:30. I want to remind you too, several of you have been turning in your survey of volunteerism, and I really appreciate that. We're hoping to hear from everyone in the congregation about the ways that you volunteer in the community and beyond, and approximately how much time you spend, whether it's weekly, monthly, or annually, so that we have an idea of how North Christian Church impacts our community and indeed the world. So if you haven't already sent us an email to the office, please do so and share with us some of the ways that you are in service and in mission in this community. And now let us begin with morning worship, and let us begin with a moment of opening prayer.
Let us pray. I'm Joy Lawler, the elder for the day. Great God, giver of the spirit and creator of all life, in the midst of winter, when so many of us seek warmth, comfort, and quiet, open us to the opportunity we have to live out Jesus' teachings. When we would close our eyes to the poor, blame the captives, and jail the oppressed, pour out your love to fill our hearts. Challenge us in this hour to pledge one action in the coming week to provide good news for the poor, release for the captives, or freedom for one who is oppressed. Amen.
I invite you to join in singing our opening hymn, number 330, Alleluia, Hear God's Story.
Story.
scripture reading this morning is Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 22. Listen for the word of God. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogue and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed upon him. And then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?"
Last week, we discussed Jesus's first miracle. Today, we will talk about Jesus's first sermon. Now, you all would have probably loved his sermon. It was short and sweet. In fact, as Joy read the scripture just now, you might not have really thought about Jesus's words as a sermon, more like a statement. "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." That's it. One sentence. The word sermon, as defined as a talk on a religious or moral subject, especially one given during a church service and based on a scripture passage from the Bible. So, Jesus's words in the synagogue on the Sabbath, based from a passage from Isaiah, do technically qualify as a sermon. I remember my first sermon. The Colorado congregation in which I grew up had a tradition that all high school seniors would give a little sermonette during Youth Sunday each year. Therefore, three of us seniors took turns in the pulpit trying to share a message that was meaningful and faithful and intelligible. Though both my parents were ordained clergy persons, I remember being a little frustrated that they didn't write my sermon for me. They offered some wisdom and some helpful tips and were a supportive first audience, but made me do the work myself. Of course, I was a nervous wreck. I had never stood behind the pulpit and in front of a congregation before, and it was a little overwhelming and intimidating. All those eyes staring at you. I don't remember what my message was or the theme or even the scripture that I preached upon, but I'm sure that I rushed through it, and I am positive that I was relieved when it was over. But what I do remember the most is being in that receiving line afterward and having all the worshipers file out of the sanctuary and shake my hand and offer positive, supportive, and reassuring compliments about what a nice message I had shared. You know how church folks are. They're so encouraging of their youth and their spiritual development. Our story from Luke's gospel is a story in two parts, and we will discover next week when we read part two, the congregation's reaction to Jesus's first sermon. Jesus didn't have it as good as I did. The community of faith that he grew up in was not amused by his message at all. But in the passage from today that the compilers of the lectionary assigned for today, it initially seems like a positive reaction. I mean, the passage ends with, "All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, 'Is not this Joseph's son?'" I like what New Testament scholar Steve Spencer says about this verse. He writes, "Though such responses may seem favorable, they are not altogether clear-cut. The Greek term rendered 'spoke well of' can also simply mean 'bore witness to.' All bore witness to him. That is, they heard his sermon, began to talk about it and evaluate it, but not necessarily approve of it. As far as being amazed at Jesus's words, that can cut two ways. Either, 'Wow, we've never heard anything like that before. That's wonderful and exciting.' Or, 'Whoa, we've never heard anything like that before. That's strange and disturbing.' 'Is not this Joseph's son?' can also cut two ways. Either, 'Wow, how about that Joseph's boy? Isn't he something? Chip off the old block, Nazareth's favorite son. We're so proud.' Or, 'Whoa, this is Joseph's kid, for goodness sake, a local laborer just like the rest of us. Where does he get off with all these highfalutin claims? Who does he think he is? He's getting above his raisin.' Is it wow or whoa? Probably a bit of both. The stunned congregation doesn't quite know what to do and what to make of this new Jesus of Nazareth, this son of Joseph." A similar story to this one from Luke appears in the other two synoptic gospels, Mark and Matthew. However, in Luke, the story is longer and more fleshed out. There's more detail about the reaction of the assembled hometown crowd, and it comes earlier in Jesus's ministry. In Luke's gospel, our story for today comes immediately after Jesus's baptism and temptation. This is his first public appearance, and in it, Jesus states clearly his message, his mission, and his purpose: to bring good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. Rob McCoy speculates the early placement of this story in Luke's gospel is key because it is foundational in understanding who Jesus is, according to the writer of Luke. He says, "Jesus's sermon articulates what Jesus is trying to accomplish. This sermon is a foundational piece for why and how a lot of people follow Jesus. They put it right up there with 'Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength,' right up there with 'Love your neighbor as yourself.' They put it right up there with 'For God so loved the world.' This is a prophetic Jesus that preaches not just personal salvation, but a world-changing social salvation as well. That's an important part of Jesus's mission. That's one heck of a wow." But on the other hand, Eric Fissler states, "This is a pivotal text in liberation theology. This is a message of good news and bad news. It's good news for those who have been oppressed and abused by the status quo. It's good news to the poor and the prisoners and the blind and the oppressed. It's bad news to those who benefit from the status quo. It's good news for those who are looking to be transformed. It's bad news for those who are not looking for transformation, but simply to be affirmed exactly the way things are. That is the difficult piece. This is a hard message to hear in a comfortable congregation. What does it mean to preach good news to the poor and realize that the people in the pews might not be the poor or predominantly the poor? What does it mean to proclaim release to the prisoners? And what does it mean when we even talk about prisoners? What does that look like? There's a lot that is challenging here. And if it's not challenging, you might not be telling the right message faithfully. Huh. A definite whoa. A wow or a woe? What do you think? How would you have reacted if you were one of Jesus's first century contemporaries hearing Jesus's sermon as he delivered it? Stay tuned next week for, as Paul Harvey always said, the rest of the story. But we are in a different position from that first audience. We hear Jesus's sermon and we know that as his followers, we too must do all that we can to bring good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. Jesus's purpose is our purpose as well. And that is both a wow and a woe. Let us pray. Living, loving God, we thank you that you sent your Son to bring a world-changing message of social salvation as well as personal salvation. Help us to do our part to lift folks out of poverty, work for justice, and help the downtrodden and dispossessed. Amen.
As we prepare for communion, let us sing and pray together our communion hymn, Thy Word is a Lamp. It's not in our hymnals, but the music is on the slides. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet.
Week by week, when we come to the table of communion and worship, we use elements from our own household to represent the bread and the cup. And we recognize these emblems of symbols of life's, of Jesus's life, death, and resurrection. For the God of love who came as an infant, who lived as a refugee, who grew into a teacher, healer, and preacher, who died at the hands of those who mocked him and nailed him to the cross, we give thanks as we remember, reflect, share, and partake. These simple elements become the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray for the bread and cup.
With our bodies, our hearts, and our souls, we worship you, O Lord our God. We gather at this table to find food for our journey toward wholeness. Feed us so that we may be able to bring hope to a desperately hurting world. Bless these gifts of bread and cup. Amen.
On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you." In a similar way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and after giving thanks, he passed it among his disciples and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood for forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me."
Law is perfect in every way.
Beautiful. Thank you, Jay. As we come to our time of prayer this morning, I'd like to lift up a few prayer concerns. First, a rare January wildfire on Central Californian coast that has burned 1,500 acres and is about 20% contained has forced the evacuations of around 500 people and has created some road closures. And it's evidence that once again that climate change has made wildfires in the West a problem year round. Fortunately, no injuries are known at this time. We pray for our siblings in the Ukraine as troops from Russia approach their borders and anxiety of an impending attack rises. We pray for those dealing with intense weather, winter weather, power outages, and roads closed to travel across the country. And we pray especially for the homeless and those without heat as brutally cold temperatures continue. We would love to be in prayer for you and what's going on in your world. Please send us your prayer concerns so that we can lift you up in prayer as well. After a moment of silent prayer, I would like to share with you a prayer by Nancy Townley that I found to be just perfect, perfectly stimulating and perfectly challenging as well. So I will pray that after we have a moment of silence. God of patience and persistence, the scriptures from Isaiah's scroll were not new to the people gathered on that day for worship. Many times before, they had heard the words and in their hearts hoped that the mandate could become a reality in their lives, but none moved forward. Then Jesus proclaimed that God had called him to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. How startled they were. At last, with confidence, Jesus forced the issues and the mandate. God has fulfilled God's promise in the person of Jesus. Now something was going to be done. No more lip service, no more fear, no more waiting. Now the time had come. It's no different today than it was 2,000 years ago. We still want someone else to pick up the reins, to lead the charge, to do the work. But God, through the witness of Jesus, is calling each of us to the task. The promise of hope and justice is given to this world, and we have become bearers of that promise. Now is the time for work and witness. Now is the time for hope and peace. Now is the time for each one of us to do our part in establishing God's kingdom. Loving God, get us ready for service. Pick us up. Dust us off and put us on the pathways of justice. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Creator God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
So I was today years old before I really thought about what recovery of sight to the blind can mean. It doesn't mean just those who are physically blind. It is also probably a reference to those who simply do not see. I don't know if you remember the old B.J. Thomas song. It says, "There is none so blind as he who will not see." So there's a lot around us that maybe we just aren't seeing. A lot of hopelessness, a lot of despair, a lot of poverty, a lot of people who are simply lost. As the pandemic rages on and politics gets crazier than ever, and we seem to have no solutions to the evils of racism, police brutality, mental illness, and hate, the world seems pretty hopeless right now. But a primary job of Christians is to never lose hope. After all, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ defeated the power of death itself. After that, all seems possible. In this winter of darkness, let us bring light. Let us declare hope loudly and clearly for all to hear. We are Christians. It's our job. If you would like to give to North Christian Church and its ministries, you may mail in your contribution or give through ACH transfer or Givelify. Let us bring light to a world lost in darkness.
Now let us sing "Every Time I Feel the Spirit," number 592 in the hymnal, or of course on your screen.
Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Upon the mountain my Lord spoke, out his mouth came fire and smoke. All around me looks so fine, ask my Lord if all was mine. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Jordan River, chilly and cold, chills the body, not the soul. Ain't but one train on this track, runs to heaven.
Have been called to do ministries of service. God goes with us in all that we do, enabling and encouraging us as we serve others. Go in peace. Amen.